हेलो फ्रेंड्स, माई सेल्फ डॉक्टर कीर्ति श्रीराम कुलकर्णी एंड आई एम फ्रॉम कोखले एजुकेशन सोसाइटीज आर्ट्स कॉमर्स एंड साइंस कॉलेज जवार। आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द थर्ड लेक्चर ऑफ SYBSC केमिस्ट्री पेपर 3 एंड वी हैव ऑलरेडी स्टार्टेड द चैप्टर दैट इज इंट्रोडक्शन टू एनालिटिकल केमिस्ट्री एंड स्टैटिस्टिकल ट्रीटमेंट ऑफ एनालिटिकल डेटा। So far now we have seen what is analytical chemistry, what is its importance and what are its objective, right? So what is analytical chemistry? That we have already discussed, that it is nothing but qualitative and quantitative determination of any component from your sample, right? So when it comes to the question that what is present in your sample and how much is present in your sample, there it comes analytical chemistry. And using various chemical analysis, you apply your knowledge in chemical analysis, that is in analytical chemistry, and then you find out what is present and how much present in your sample. So we have seen various definitions also, that is accuracy, precision, reproducibility, sensitivity, selectivity, limit of detection. And now in this lecture we will actually see what are the different chemical analysis methods that we apply for our experiments. So in analytical chemistry we perform chemical analysis for doing what? To separate, identify and quantify the matter. So see, the definition itself will tell you about that whenever you are given a sample, what you have to do? First of all, you have to separate it, right? So you have to separate the components of your given mixture or your sample. If you don't separate that, what you will do further? Nothing. So first step is to separate the component of your sample. Then in second step, what you have to do? You have to identify, okay? So in given sample, what are the different components are present, that you have to identify by various methods. And finally, you have to quantify the component, how much is present, right? So these three steps are very important in analytical chemistry. And to perform these three steps, we use some methods. And those methods are called as classical or non-classical methods of analysis, right? So what you basically do? So in first step, that is in separation step, what you have to do? You have to isolate your analyte. You have to separate your components from the mixture. Then in second step, you have to perform qualitative analysis. Means for identification of your component, you have to perform qualitative analysis. What is its nature? What is its color? What are its different physical and chemical properties? Using these steps or using these experiments, you can find out what is present in your component. And the third step is quantitative analysis. So it will determine the numerical amount of analyte for its concentration. So in given sample, your required component is present in how much amount, that you can find out using quantitative analysis. So to perform all these steps, all these experiments, chemical analysis is classified into two types, that is classical and non-classical methods of analysis. Means whatever I have explained till now, to perform these steps, you have to carry out classical or non-classical method of analysis. So now see, we can see what are the classical methods, very first one. So they are the traditional methods in which we carry out in routine laboratories. Okay, the name itself will suggest you what is the meaning. That means the methods which you apply from your traditional way are called as classical methods. So what are their characteristics? They are simple apparatus and simple procedures. Second, they are cheap in nature. And third one, no specialized training is required. Okay, so whenever it comes to classical method of analysis, how they are? They are very simple one, they are cheaper, no expensive experiments or instruments are required, And the third one, you don't require very specialized kind of training. Okay, so using these simple methods, you can apply your knowledge in classical method of analysis. But also there are some disadvantages. What are these disadvantages? They are less accurate and less sensitive. So we have already discussed about some of our definitions that our experiment or our method should be very accurate or should be very sensitive. But in this case, they are not much accurate or much sensitive. Second one, they are laborious and time consuming. Obviously, the method which are cheap and non-expensive, obviously they are laborious. There you have to perform more work, and obviously for more work you will require more time. So they are more laborious and more time consuming. Third one, speed of analysis is slow. Obviously, if you perform the experiment with your hand or with manual way, you have to take more and more time. So speed of analysis is slow. And last one, applicability is limited. So whenever you perform your experiment, its applications are limited. These are some advantages and disadvantages of classical methods. So now you will have a question in your mind, that is, what are the different classical methods? So from our childhood, from 9, 10 standard or in 11, 12 standard, we have already performed this classical method of analysis. So the name itself will tell you, they are gravimetric and volumetric analysis. So these two methods are called as classical methods of analysis. In any sample, what is present, how much present, that you can identify using these two simple and non-expensive ways, that is gravimetric and volumetric analysis. So these two are example of classical method of analysis. So we will see the first one, what is gravimetric analysis. So if you remember in your 11th or 12th standard, you have used some apparatus called as crucible. You remember that? So you were given some component or some compound in that, you have heated it for some time and some part of that got vaporized. And then what you do? After that, the residue you weigh and then you determine its composition, right? So that was the experiment called as gravimetric analysis. So wasn't it simple, right? So that's why it is called as classical method, simple method of analysis. So what happens in gravimetric analysis? See the definition. In this method, iron under estimation is converted into precipitate of known composition. Okay, so whatever component you have got, that is of unknown composition or unknown concentration. So first of all, you have to convert it into known amount of precipitate. After formation of precipitate, it is digested, ignited, and finally it is weighed. So after weighing, you have to perform calculation to find out its concentration. Gravimetric analysis is divided into direct and indirect gravimetric analysis. So what are these different steps, how they are performed and what are their importance, that we will see detail in this chapter, right? So you just remember these steps, what are there in your gravimetric analysis. So second type of classical method is called as volumetric analysis. Okay. So whatever apparatus you have used, okay, conical flask, pipettes, burettes, I think you remember all this. So that you have to perform in your volumetric analysis. That is, in this method, measurement of volume of gas during chemical reaction is quantitatively correlated. Okay, so volumetric, the term itself shows you about volume, and that volume is of gas. Okay. So it is a little bit tedious to understand, and therefore third type of classical method is given, which is similar to volumetric analysis, that is known as titrimetric analysis. So in titrimetric measurements, volume of reacting substances are used. Okay. So whatever solutions you are using, that are measured in titrimetric analysis. So in titration, what you are doing, very simple way, in burette you fill some solution and that solution is of known concentration and known volume, right? So both concentration and volume of burette solution are known to you, and they are titrated with the unknown concentration but known volume of solution that you take in your conical flask. Okay, so using some indicator you perform the titration, and in that way you find out the unknown concentration. So what formula you use there? M1V1 is equal to N2V2. Okay, so it can be also N1V1 is equal to N2V2. It can be normality or molarity of that particular solution, right? So titrimetric analysis are further classified into four types, that are acid-base titration, precipitation titration, complexometric titration and redox titration. So the way you perform your experiment, they are classified into these four types. So these are all four types or different type of classical method of chemical analysis. So just have a glance on this picture, so you can easily get the idea about gravimetry and titrimetry. So in gravimetry, you might have performed cone of your paper, filter paper, and then you have burnt it or you have digested your precipitate. So whatever experiment is there, we will see in detail in later part of our chapter. And titration, see, titrimetry is very easy. You have already performed last year. So they are very simple methods, inexpensive. Also, they are giving good results. So therefore, widely they are used in all over laboratories in world. So these are two methods of classical methods of analysis, that is gravimetry and titrimetry. So when it comes to next part, that is now non-classical, or they are also known as instrumental method of analysis. Simple, first was classical, there no much instruments were used, and the second part is non-classical method, they are also known as instrumental methods. So now we will see what are their characteristics. So very first one, they need specially designed laboratory and sophisticated instruments. Very simple, you have to use instrument means you need some sophistication, you need knowledge how to handle them, how to find out the result, and therefore they should be very well designed. Therefore, when you perform instrumental analysis, you have to use a design, very well designed laboratory and sophisticated instrument with proper procedure, right? So second one is they are accurate and sensitive. Obviously, when your manual work will decrease, the instrumental work will increase and they will provide you more accuracy and more sensitivity. So whatever result you will get, they will be obviously more accurate and more sensitive. The third one is they provide you exact estimation of components in qualitative and quantitative manner. Whenever you perform any experiment using instruments, obviously they will give you proper idea of its quality and proper idea of its quantity. So what is present and how much present is very easily determined using non-classical, that means instrumental method of analysis. Next one, they are expensive. Means what? Obviously you are using instruments, so you have to pay a little bit more for that. So they are little bit more expensive. But what are their advantages? So they will require less time. Okay, so whenever you perform the experiment, they will be less time consuming. And obviously they will be speedy in nature. Okay, so instrument will perform your experiment fast, and therefore time requirement is less. The fifth one is only small quantity of sample is required. So see, sometime you get very small sample, some rare species of compounds or anything which is not available in a bulk. So there your sample is very small, right? And therefore you required very small quantity of sample for your instrumental methods. The sixth one is instrumental methods measure physical properties like conductivity, potential, लाइट एब्जॉर्प्शन और इमिशन, मास टू चार्ज रेशो एंड रेडियो एक्टिविटी. सो सी द नेम्स, द नेम इट विल सजेस्ट यू सम प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ योर सब्सटेंस. कंडक्टिविटी, पोटेंशियल, राइट, रेडियो एक्टिविटी. सो दीज आर सम फिजिकल प्रॉपर्टी बेस्ड ऑन व्हिच योर इंस्ट्रूमेंट इज डेवलप्ड. ओके, सो व्हाट योर इंस्ट्रूमेंट विल डू, द इंस्ट्रूमेंट विल फाइंड आउट व्हाट इज द चेंज. ओके, इनिशियल स्टेट एंड द नेक्स्ट स्टेप. सो इन दैट स्टेप देयर इज ऑलवेज चेंज इन योर प्रॉपर्टी एंड दैट चेंज इज मेजर्ड बाय योर इंस्ट्रूमेंट एंड देयरफॉर द इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स आर बेस्ड अपॉन दीज वेरियस कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स और वेरियस फिजिकल प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ योर कंपोनेंट. ओके, सो नाउ वी विल सी व्हाट आर द वेरियस इंस्ट्रूमेंटल मेथड्स. सो ऑलरेडी वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट क्लासिकल मेथड्स, दे वेयर ऑफ टू टाइप्स, राइट, ग्रेविमेट्रिक एंड वॉल्यूमेट्रिक. एंड व्हाट आर इंस्ट्रूमेंटल मेथड्स, सो सी द एग्जांपल्स. वेरी फर्स्ट वन इज कॉल्ड एज ऑप्टिकल मेथड्स. ओके, सो ऑप्टिकल इटसेल्फ सजेस्ट यू दैट इट इज रिलेटेड टू लाइट. ओके, सो लाइट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट प्रॉपर्टी. It is there for every, each and every matter. So depending upon change in property of light, the instruments are developed like spectrophotometry, colorimetry, polarimetry, nephelometry, turbidimetry and Raman scattering. So all these methods depends upon different characteristics or different physical property. The main thing is same, that is light. Okay. So light will show you different effects in this instruments, and therefore you get different results. So these techniques are based upon first property, that is optical methods or light. So the optical methods, it involves electromagnetic radiation interaction with the matter. The second method is called as electroanalytical method. Okay. So the name itself tell you about, it is something interaction of electron that and analytical method. So what happens in that? They use electrically conductive probes called as electrodes. Okay, so in electroanalytical methods, you have to use apparatus or probes called as electrode, which make electrical contact with the analyte solution. So wherever solution is provided to you and you have to find out the concentration, unknown concentration, you have to dip your electrodes in that. And what it will do? It will measure the change in an electrical parameter of the solution. Okay. So what can be those different parameters? They are their types. Okay. So the types are, see, voltammetry, conductometry, potentiometry, coulometry and electrogravimetry. So these are all different properties of substance. They are also known as electroanalytical properties. So in voltammetry, what will happen? The sample is made part of electrolytic cell and the current resistor in the circuit is measured at a definite value of applied potential. So in simple language, you have to measure the change in voltage for this method. In conductometry, the name itself suggests to you that it will measure the conductance. What is conductance? It is the ability of solution to carry an electrical current. Okay. So in conductometry, you have to measure the change in conductance of your sample. The third one is potentiometry. So what is potential? You have to find out the change in potential difference between two electrodes. Next one is coulometry. Coulometry is the method in which you have to monitor the quantity of electricity that is in coulombs, which is consumed during electrochemical reaction involved in the analyte. So in coulometry, you will have to find out the change in coulombs, that is quantity of electricity. Next one is electrogravimetry. So now what is that? It is nothing but the combination of classical gravimetry and the instrumental method, that is electroanalytical method. So the classical method and non-classical method is combined to find out the weight of precipitate or the unknown concentration, which is known as electrogravimetry. So in the all this myth, you can find out that instrumental method depends upon various physical properties of the substance. They can be either electromagnetic radiation interaction, that can be optical methods, or they can be electroanalytical methods like described in this slide. So see this one. Here you get the idea about what are different instrumental methods. So first one is about potentiometer. There you have to use electrodes which are dipped in solution, and then you can find out change in potential. Okay, so that is its physical property. The next one is a block diagram of basic colorimeter. Okay, so colorimeter depends upon light, and therefore you can see there is some light source, some lenses, and then your sample holder, and finally you can see some detectors which will give you idea of our result. So this is just basic idea about how the instrumental methods are used for your chemical analysis. So I think up till now you might have understand that what we are performing chemical analysis or why we are performing chemical analysis. So whatever knowledge you have applied in your remaining science, within comes to analytical chemistry, you have to find out what is present in your given sample or unknown sample, and in how much matter, how much quantity it is present. So to perform this, you have to find out chemical analysis method, a suitable chemical analysis method to find out quality and quantity of that particular matter, right? But only chemical analysis or these methods are not important. But before that, you have to separate your sample, right? So separation is also very important. And what are those separation techniques, that we will see in our next slide. So before applying your knowledge to your particular component, right? So suppose you take the example of any type of soil. So in that soil, different type of components are present. Trace amount of metal is present. Some pieces of glass is present. Some different type of pesticides are present. So these are different components of your sample. So before analyzing them, it is very necessary to separate them, right? So the chemical analysis is also important along with separation techniques. Okay, so what are those separation techniques? They are necessary for separating the components of interest from your mixture or from your matrix. Okay, so suppose you are giving a random sample, and then you are said that, okay, find out what is present, how much is present. So very first step is to separate them from each other. You have to separate its components, and therefore separation techniques are very important. So the separation technique of the component from its mixture are of two types. So the first one is called as solvent extraction. Okay, so what is this separation technique? In this method, component of a mixture are separated using suitable solvent. And which property is used here? It is called as distribution. Okay, so distribution of component into immiscible liquids is called as solvent extraction. What are these methods? That we will see later in detail. So here you can see this type of apparatus is called as separating funnel. Okay, so using this separating funnel, you can separate the two layers of immiscible liquids. Okay, and that way you can separate the components. So the first type of separation technique is called as solvent extraction. And which property is used here? That is distribution. The second separation technique is very important, which is called as chromatography. So I think you have known this word. So what is its method? This is the separation method in which component separate on the basis of stationary phase and mobile phase. Okay, so whenever you want to separate your component, they must have some different properties from each other, then only they can separate from each other. So in first property, they will get dissolved or they will get visible with the immiscible solvents, that is solvent extraction. And in chromatography, what they will do? The component will retain or they will flow along with the mobile phase. Okay, so this technique also we will see in detail, but in this stage you remember that the chromatography is also an important technique where the components have property to retain themselves in stationary phase or they can flow with mobile phase. So what are different type of chromatographic experiments? They are paper chromatography or thin layer chromatography. So in this, what you have to perform? You have to take paper, on that you have to put some mixture and you have to apply a solvent system. So slowly after some time the component get separated from each other. Okay, so in this we have discussed about different classical and non-classical method of analysis and the separation techniques, that is solvent extraction and chromatography. Thank you.